Hola a todos, estamos aquí con Somos Familia. Hoy vamos a estar haciendo un programa enfocado en el mes de la historia negra. So, hi everyone, today our program is going to be focusing on celebrating and honoring Black History Month. Our facilitators are myself, Fabiola López, and Andrew Martin, and our special guest is Venus Johnson. So, los facilitadores de hoy soy yo, Fabiola López, y Andrew Martin, y nuestra invitada especial de hoy es Venus Johnson.
Hi everyone. So my name is Andrew, and so we're gonna kind of go over through the table of contents. So the agenda is gonna kind of follow through today as like introductions of ourselves. We're gonna talk about what is Black history, why do we celebrate it. We're gonna kind of divulge ourselves in education. So Venus will also be helping us facilitate this conversation, followed by importance of HBCUs because we really think it's important to have that within our conversation, considering that it is Black History Month. And it's also important that we highlight some historical figures. And followed by that, we're gonna watch a short film created by a Black creator, and it's also an Oscar-winning film. So I'm really excited about that. And then afterwards, we'll go ahead and close.
So, como dijo Andrew, nuestra agenda es la siguiente. So, vamos a estar hablando de la importancia del mes de la historia negra y luego vamos a seguir con una conversación sobre la educación, sobre el sistema de educación americano público. Y en eso nos va a ayudar nuestra invitada Venus Johnson en compartir su experiencia. Y también vamos a hablar de la importancia de los colegios y universidades históricamente negros. Y luego vamos a seguir con una discusión sobre figuras históricas que sentimos que es muy importante honrar. Y luego vamos a cerrar con una película corta que se llama Hair Love y que ganó un Oscar y que fue creada por Matthew A. Cherry.
So we're going to go ahead and quickly introduce ourselves. So I can go ahead and start. So hola a todos, me llamo Andrew Martin. Y uso los pronombres he, him, él en español. And my connection to Somos Familia is that I am the Member Engagement Associate. And so I work with the Combating Anti-Blackness Committee and the Membership Committee. And we work towards really trying to get people more engaged within the organization. And at the same time, we really try to unlearn and learn racism, prejudices, and old practices that we may have had in the past. And so I can go ahead and pass over to Fabiola.
Thank you, Andrew. Hi, so my name is Fabiola López. My pronouns are she, her, hers. And my connection to Somos Familia is that I work in community engagement. So I primarily work in engaging more volunteers and retaining more volunteers as we are a volunteer-run organization. So that's like the heart of our org and our work. And I also work primarily with the Self-Care Saturdays programming, which is this, just to present different self-care topics relevant to our culture and our community, especially in the times of the pandemic. So mi nombre es Fabiola López, mis pronombres son ella, y mi conexión a Somos Familias que trabajo con alcance comunitario, so específicamente con alcance a voluntarios en la comunidad, como nuestra organización depende de esos voluntarios. Y también trabajo en los sábados de bienestar, como este programa, para presentar diferentes temas sobre el autocuidado que son relevantes a nuestra cultura, a nuestra comunidad, especialmente en los tiempos de la pandemia. También les quiero dejar saber que vamos a estar haciendo este programa en inglés y español, so vamos a tener que traducir todo lo que decimos, so tengan paciencia con nosotros. Y se lo paso a Venus Johnson, so I pass it to Venus to introduce herself.
Awesome. Hi, everyone. I am Venus Johnson. My pronouns are she, her. I am a junior strategic legal communications major from Howard University. And my connection to the Somos Familia is Andrew Martin. Andrew and I go way back to middle school at San Onofre Elementary School slash middle school here in San Clemente, California. So I am so honored that he reached out and came to me so I could speak and give voice to Black history. And it's important to know that Black history is very much so American history. So I'm very honored to be here and to share a little of my story.
Thank you, Venus. So Venus Johnson, sus pronombres son she, her, ella. Su conexión a Somos Familia es por parte de Andrew, porque fueron a la como primaria juntas en San Clemente. Venus está estudiando comunicaciones estratégicas y legales con un minor en ciencias políticas en Howard University. Está en su tercer año. Y no más que decir que está muy agradecida de estar en este espacio y de poder compartir la importancia del mes de la historia negra. Y también quiere decirles a ustedes que pues, la historia negra es parte de la historia americana, ¿verdad? Solo tenemos que dar su importancia y acordarnos que es parte de nuestra historia. Thank you so much, Venus. So moving on to Andrew, if you want to take the lead on this, sorry.
Yeah, so moving forward, we're really going to begin with what is Black History Month and like, why do we really celebrate it? And so I think to really answer this is Black History Month is an annual celebration of achievements by African Americans and Black individuals. And I feel like we celebrate this month because we really want to recognize and honor these Black Americans and their role in the United States history. And I say this because I feel like we have a lack of that. We celebrate and honor, I feel like, people who have done really bad things in the past and haven't done too much for the community. And I feel like there have been a lot of Black Americans that haven't been recognized as much. And it's really important that we use this month to recognize and honor them. And one thing I also want to state is that it's important that we not honor and recognize the individuals from the past, but it's really important to honor and recognize those who are currently doing work now. So I think that's also another important aspect that I wanted to really emphasize. And then
So para seguir con lo que dijo Andrew, básicamente en los modos más básicos, el mes de la historia negra es una celebración de los logros y la historia de la comunidad negra, específicamente en los Estados Unidos, pero también es una celebración que se reconoce en muchos países en el mundo. Es importante que en este mes celebremos y reconocemos y honramos a los americanos negros y su papel en la historia. Como dijo Vines, es parte de la historia americana. Y también algo que pensamos que es muy importante es que honremos no solo el trabajo y los activistas y las figuras del pasado, pero también en el presente, porque hay muchas personas y figuras en la comunidad haciendo trabajo muy maravilloso en el presente, pero también es muy importante que reconocemos que los mismos problemas siguen pasando en la comunidad, ¿verdad? En el mundo, y es una lucha que sigue hasta este día y no nomás es algo que existió en el pasado. So going off from that, Venus, if you'd like to like share anything that we missed or anything that you feel is really important to share.
Yeah, I think everything that you all said was perfect. And I really enjoy the aspect of also giving honor to not just Black distinguished Americans from the past, but also those who are currently doing the work, because there's so many that are currently doing the work and that deserve to be recognized. And, you know, I'll just be very honest and transparent. As a young African-American woman growing up on the West Coast, I absolutely loved Black History Month every February. However, I can't, you know, come on here and not be realistic and think, well, wow, why is it just this one month? You know, it needs to be Black History Month all 12 months of the year. So I didn't truly understand that until I went to a HBCU, until I was immersed in my culture. And I was like, you know, it's Black History Month every single day when we're on campus, because I'm looking at my Black brother, my Black sister. And even it's also important to know that not just Black people go to HBCUs, you know, so they are completely, we do have some diversity on campus. But just to be in a space to recognize and honor Black individuals year round is important. Like I said, Black history is American history. And oftentimes in our educational system growing up, we're fed and read and we're taught such a small section of it, you know? I can be honest and say here on the West Coast, you know, we're reading books that aren't from Black authors, that aren't Black literature. It's all of the Europeanized culture that we're being fed. And so we have to make it our duty to go outside of that and honor our Black history every single month, but especially this month.
Thank you so much for that. So, So, como compartió Vines, dijo que le encanta el aspecto de no nomás honrar a la gente en el pasado, pero honrar a la gente en el presente, porque como dice, hay mucha gente maravillosa en la comunidad y en el mundo y en la sociedad haciendo este mismo trabajo y haciendo cosas muy importantes para sus derechos y para su comunidad. Y quiere ser honesta que como una mujer negra creciendo en el oeste en los Estados Unidos, le encantaba el mes de la historia negra y le encantaba aprender de eso, lo poco que aprendía en la escuela, ¿verdad? Pero lo que también vino a ver cuando fue al colegio, que fue Howard University, que es un HBCU, es que no nomás debía ser ese solo mes, debía ser todos los 12 meses del año donde honramos y celebramos la cultura y la comunidad y su papel en la historia, y que eso no fue algo que vio hasta que llegó a Howard y estuvo en su cultura y estuvo alrededor de hermanos negros también que celebran esa cultura y que comparten esa cultura. Y algo que ve nuestro sistema de educación es que hay mucha falta de educación cuando viene al mes de la historia negra y a la historia negra en general, que todos los libros, toda la educación, toda la historia que nos da ese sistema, esa historia de Europa, esa historia escrita por gente blanca. Y tenemos que hacer el trabajo nosotros para pelear por más representación y para aprender la historia verdadera. So now we want to share more and talk more about the educational system in the U.S. So talking about the educational system in terms of the public system of K-12 and also HBCUs and their relation with Black history and the Black community. So ahora queremos hablar del sistema de educación, el sistema público de primaria hasta prepa y también de los colegios universitarios, universidades históricamente negras y sus relaciones con la cultura, la historia y la comunidad negra.
Yeah, so we're going to go through, we're going to have some conversations about like our K-12 education and what we experienced growing up. So one of the first questions that anyone feel free to answer, what has your experience been with the K-12 public school system in relation to Black history, education, culture, et cetera?
Well, I can definitely jump off and say, yeah. Through the K-12 public school system, and I'll also note that I'm a military child, so I have moved from school to school, so I've experienced different schools, different public school systems, and different Department of Defense schools, because most of the time my schools were on a military base, so I was immersed in that education. And every space, everything, from school to school, from place to place that I moved, the one thing that tied every experience together was I was often the only Black girl in the room. And with that being said, every time when it comes to Black education and when we're talking about just not even if we're going to talk about, you know, slavery and all the harsh education that we were taught, but just the entire realm of Black education, it's always like, oh my gosh, all eyes are on me. Like, what am I gonna say? Like, it's my duty to express my Black needs in this European space, which isn't always it's not my duty to do so. You know, it's the duty of those European spaces to accurately reflect my history. And so I'm realizing that the K-12 education system does not the best job of reflecting Black history, Black education, Black culture, Black rhetoric, Black mathematicians, Black scientists. You know, there's so much that's left out, and it's really disappointing, but our history deserves to be told in truth and with accuracy. And it's time to take pride in that and to take pride in Black education and understand the prominent role that it has in our history. You know, there's so much that we miss out on, and it's just time for us to go out and seek it on our own, because our educational systems so far have not done a good job of reflecting that. However, also, I will say, I have been on the campaign trail. I am a campaign manager for, in this past election, I was a campaign manager. And so I will always on any platform get on and say, it's our civic duty to be more civically engaged. And especially in local politics. This past November election, me campaigning a local election, I really understood the importance of local politics. And especially for our youth, we need to get out there and understand local policy so that we can help fix our local education, our local K through 12, you know, and it's just who's running in our backyards, who's running for office right here in our neighborhoods, you know, who are we electing? Do they understand the importance of Black education in the K through 12 system? Do they understand Black culture? Do they understand the importance of HBCUs? Do our counselors understand? And so, you know, one of my mottos is when you know more, you do more. When you know better, you do better. So it's just about education. It's about getting out there and fulfilling your civic role to attend a city council meeting, you know, vote, make sure that the people you are electing into office, they care about Black education in the K through 12 system. So yeah, so I could go on and on about that all day. So yeah.
No, I absolutely love that. Thank you for sharing that. And just to like, so it's accessible to our audience, I'll just translate that really quick, but this conversation continues. Quería compartir, Vines, que sí hay mucha falta de educación negra en nuestro sistema. Ella, como un joven que creció con una familia en el militar, se movió mucho a diferentes escuelas, diferentes comunidades, estados, y todo lo que, la cosa que todos esos lugares tenían es que muchas veces ella era la única persona negra en el cuarto, ¿verdad? La única mujer negra. So cuando se hablaba de diferentes cosas, como no nomás la esclavitud, pero diferentes problemas negros en la comunidad negra, todos los ojos estaban en ella, ¿verdad? Y era la, esperaban los maestros que ella pudiera educarlos en esos problemas y esos diferentes temas. Y como ella dice, no es su trabajo de ella de educar a otras personas, no es su trabajo de ella de llenar esos espacios que la gente blanca deja, ¿verdad? Es el trabajo de los espacios blancos, especialmente en la educación, de educarse correctamente y dar esa historia y esa educación a otra gente, ¿verdad? So, ella, como dice, el sistema de educación no hace el mejor trabajo en hacer eso, no nomás cuando viene la educación negra, pero también, y a la esclavitud, pero también a gente en las ciencias y matemáticas negras, escritores negros, diferentes, en diferentes aspectos, ¿verdad? Ella dice que es tiempo de que tomar orgullo y verdaderamente aprender esa historia y todos los logros de la comunidad negra y meter esto a todos los cuartos en las escuelas y al sistema de educación en general. Y que es tiempo que, como el sistema de educación no lo hace él mismo, es tiempo que nosotros salgamos y nos eduquemos nosotros mismos, porque no lo vamos a agarrar el sistema de educación si no hay cambios. Algo que ella también compartió es todo lo que aprendió cuando estaba trabajando en campañas como un líder y vio la importancia de la política local, de la política en tu misma comunidad, que siempre que nosotros salgamos y votemos en mente con nuestros hijos, ¿verdad? ¿Qué queremos que aprendan ellos? ¿Quién queremos que sea líder de nuestra comunidad? ¿Les importa la educación negra? ¿Saben de los HBCUs? ¿Les importa incluir a los jóvenes negros y asegurarse que su historia y su comunidad sea respetada y honrada? So ella dice que hay mucha importancia en votar, en salir a juntas de tu ciudad, en saber quién es el líder de tu ciudad y asegurar que refleje las necesidades y lo que les importa a la comunidad, especialmente a la comunidad negra en todas nuestras ciudades.
I think. No, thank you for translating that, well, Fabiola. I know it's definitely a lot. For me, I could resonate a little bit with Venus because I did also grow up in a military household, so I understand what it's like to experience different education systems. And so, for me, in my experience, I think what I've noticed is depending on the region of where your education system is the education they will teach you. What I mean by this is when I had went to a predominantly white school in Southern California, I was taught a lot about white history. And it wasn't until I moved to Washington, DC, where I went to a predominantly Black high school, where all I was learning about was African-American culture, where I was learning about cultures that weren't just European culture. I was learning about diverse education, diverse individuals, people who really played a role in US history that wasn't European. And I feel like based off my experience, education really will stem from the area you grew up in or the area that education system is from, because there is a lot of like different regions have a lot of ties with different ideologies. And so because of that, obviously they're going to present the education in the way they want to present it. And so that has been my experience within the K through 12 public school system. And I feel like in relation to Black history, education and culture, a lot of these educations lack that. And I feel like we need to move forward. But for regions that do have a large population of Black individuals, minority communities, a lot of that education will be catered towards them, if that makes sense. And I feel like that's what I have experienced growing up.
I don't know if you want to try to share that in Spanish as well, Andrew.
I can go ahead and try, but I will say, feel free to jump in to help me because you know how I am. Actually, is it possible if you may translate a little bit for me?
Yeah. Okay.
Thank you.
Solo principalmente lo que dijo Andrew es que la educación depende mucho de dónde vives y dónde creces, o él creciendo en unos lugares más blancos o con menos gente negra o menos minorías de diferentes comunidades, es que lo que se aprende es la historia blanca, lo que se aprende es la historia que ha escrito la gente blanca y la comunidad blanca. Y lo que ha notado es que cuando ha ido a escuelas donde hay más gente latinx o más gente negra o más gente afro-latinx, es que se aprende más de la historia negra, ¿verdad? De la gente y las figuras históricas negras y lo que han hecho para la comunidad. Y nomás esa historia más específicamente. Eso lo que él piensa es que a veces depende mucho de dónde vives. La educación depende mucho en qué estado, si es más conservativo, qué comunidades viven ahí. Solo que él ve mucho la importancia de que en ciertas comunidades se aprende más sobre ciertas historias y que eso debía ser algo que se aplique a todas, ¿verdad? If that more or less.
No, yeah, that summed it up. Thank you so much.
Yeah. And I just want to say, like, I completely agree with both of you, especially like what you spoke on, Andrew, about growing up in different areas. Because I grew up in a mostly like Latinx community, like we're all Latinx. But there wasn't many Black students in our communities, in our schools. And even more so from that disconnect of like the gaps in the Latinx community when it comes to the Black community, it was also like, we are very far removed from our educators. Like all of my teachers would be white. None of them would live in our city. They'd all live in like richer, more affluent areas and would come here to like teach like the little kids in Baldwin Park, you know? So there was a very big lack. And I think Andrew and I had a conversation about this recently where it was like, we did not even know the ways that we were being conditioned. We didn't even realize the gaps in our education because we were like 10, you know, sometimes you don't see. So especially in seventh and eighth grade, we learned a lot about indigenous communities and it was just terrible. They taught us that the conquistadores did such great things for this area. They talked about brutalities. They touched upon it very, very lightly. They took us to missions. They would make us build missions. They never taught us about the atrocities that happened and the atrocities of colonization. And when it came to slavery, we learned even less. I don't know. It was really, really just a big gap and like so many things that were left out. And I think even going on into high school, you don't learn enough about it. You know, in APUSH, you learn only about white figures. You learn that Thomas Jefferson wasn't that bad of a guy. It's just there's a very big gap. And I think even going on to college, there's still, especially in like predominantly white institutions, there's still a big gap. You know, you can seek out certain courses, you can seek out certain education, but I think many times the system of education isn't going to give you the education you need. So like Venus said, you have to seek it out on your own, you know, within community members. You have to take the strides to kind of educate yourself, which can be tough, but many times like the gaps in our education system is going to take a while. So we kind of had to take that step to educate ourselves. So yo dije como compartiendo como algo similar a lo que compartió Andrew, es que a veces la educación depende mucho de dónde creces. So yo crecí en una comunidad mayoritariamente Latinx, pero no había muchos estudiantes negros. So, y también arriba de eso, muchos de mis maestros eran blancos. Eran maestros que no vivían en mi ciudad, no eran Latinx, vivían en áreas más ricas y venían a educarnos aquí, viéndonos como niños más pobres o más mal educados que ellos. Y muchas veces cuando aprendíamos sobre las comunidades negras, sobre las comunidades indígenas, no aprendíamos la historia verdadera, ¿verdad? Aprendíamos cómo la escribió la gente blanca, cómo la escribió la gente que era las figuras malas en esos tiempos, que eran los que les gustaba la esclavitud, que eran los que hacían violencia contra comunidades indígenas. So, había mucha falta de lo que aprendíamos. Y también dando a la prepa en high school, no aprendes mucho. La historia que aprendes es la historia blanca porque es la historia que ha sido escrita y es la historia que el sistema te quiere dar. Y también compartí que en el colegio a veces puedes buscar más educación, más inclusiva, más educación que te enseña la historia verdadera, pero especialmente en instituciones que todavía son muy blancas, como Berkeley, no te da la educación verdadera. Busques lo que busques. Eso es muy importante, que la busques tú misma en tu comunidad, entre miembros de tu comunidad, y que te eduques tú misma, porque el sistema no te va a dar la educación que necesitas. And we also got a quick question. I think this is Maritza. She says, what are some ways to build stronger solidarity between Latinx and Black communities? Of course, with acknowledgement to the fact that many people are both Black and Latinx.
I think really one important thing on that, it's simple, but not a lot of people take that step forward, is just trying to learn in and learn. So I feel like that's something that we are doing right now, but not a lot of people really practice that. So they will say like, yeah, let's go ahead and like learn about like Black culture, Latinx culture. But I think it's really important to like really divulge yourselves within that and educating yourself, because I feel like once you understand the other side of the story and they understand yours, there's much easier communication. And I feel like that could really build solidarity between two different communities.
Are you going to translate or could I?
Yeah, I'll translate real quick. So los pensamientos que compartió Andrew, es que es muy importante que nosotros tomemos el trabajo de desaprender y aprender, ¿verdad? Dentro de la comunidad Latinx, de desaprender los prejuicios y el racismo. Y él piensa que es muy fácil que a veces la gente diga, pues voy a aprender más sobre la cultura, sobre la comunidad, pero toma más que eso. Toma que de veras hagamos el trabajo de desaprender eso, que es un trabajo muy largo, ¿verdad? Y él piensa que si hacemos ese trabajo va a ser más fácil tener comunicación entre comunidades y más fácil entender la experiencia de otras personas y así más fácil en crear solidaridad. Yeah, passing it to Venus.
Awesome. I completely agree with Andrew. And the first thing that's popping up to my head, which is ironic because it was definitely, I think, on my AP Lang read books that we must read, To Kill a Mockingbird. So, and I know Scout tells Atticus Finch, I think his dad, her dad, and says, you never truly know, or I'm sorry, her dad tells Scout, you never truly know someone's reality or their path until you get in their shoes and you walk around in it. So until I get in my shoe, in someone else's shoes, from a different culture, a different experience, a different lifestyle, different race, ethnicity, until I put myself in their shoes and walk around a little bit, I can't even come to the table and educate. I can't even speak to their experience unless I get in their shoes and walk around a bit. And so it's not just about having the conversations, the uncomfortable conversations. That's an important factor, don't get me wrong. However, it's about application. Okay, we had that conversation. Now what are you gonna go do with it? We have so many amazing organizations. I know here in North San Diego County for sure, and I'm sure, you know, organizations like this, there's so many organizations that have the resources, have the tools, have the manpower, the people. There's so many organizations that are already doing the work. We just need to go walk in their shoes and walk around a bit and, you know, experience and apply. Take a moment. And it's really interesting when you look at, and I don't want to say politics, but I want to say policy, because it's about policy, you know. When you look at policy and you realize a lot of our politicians or policymakers, they're making decisions on realities that they've never lived. And, you know, granted, of course, not everybody is going to be able to come from, be so well-rounded and come from every experience, but you need to at least have somebody on your team who did experience that. You need to have somebody on your team who did walk around in that experience, and you need to partner with them so that you can get, you can engulf yourself in that experience and then go vote on that policy, then go vote on K through 12 education, then go vote on LGBTQIA plus rights, you know, then go vote on that. Did you walk around in those shoes? Did you do the work before you casted that vote? And so I think about that a lot as I venture on into policy. I don't want to say politics, but policy. And I think about that, and I just hope that we continue. It's also our duty. It's a two-way street. It's about accountability. And we hold those in power accountable for just that, you know? So it's about accountability, and it's about bridging the gap and truly applying ourselves to that, to that, to that vision. Thank you.
I love that. Thank you so much for sharing. Yeah, Venus lo que compartió eso, empezó con una conversación sobre To Kill a Mockingbird, que es un libro muy popular en nuestro sistema de educación. Y algo que ella agarró de ese libro y que siempre se le ha quedado en su mente es cuando uno de los personajes le dice a su hija que nunca sabes la realidad de alguien hasta que caminas en sus pasos. Y es algo que ella ha cargado con ella en su educación y en su trabajo, que no nomás es sobre esa conversación, ¿verdad? Sobre esas conversaciones que son incómodas, que son duras, pero es de veras hacer el trabajo, de tener esa conversación y decir, ¿ahora qué vamos a hacer, verdad? So es sobre aplicar lo que aprendemos en esas conversaciones. Lo que ella mencionó es que hay muchas organizaciones, especialmente ella dice en su área, que es en el condado de San Diego, en el norte, que hay muchas organizaciones con el recurso, con las personas, con la experiencia que está haciendo ese trabajo ya, ¿verdad? Que está haciendo ese trabajo en las comunidades negras, en las comunidades latinx. So es más bien de encontrar esas organizaciones y trabajar con ellas, ¿verdad? Que caminar en esos pasos, agarrar esa experiencia, aplicar lo que aprendemos de esas conversaciones. También hablo mucho de la ley, la política, la póliza, y la importancia de caminar en esos pasos cuando viene la política, ¿verdad? Que muchos políticos, mucha gente en la ley, mucha gente en el gobierno está votando en cosas que ellos no tienen ninguna idea de eso, ¿verdad? No viven en esas comunidades, no han vivido esa realidad. Y que también para esos equipos es importante tener a alguien que sí ha pasado en esos pasos, que sí ha vivido en esa comunidad, que sí vive en el mundo como una persona negra, como una persona afro-latinx, como una persona latinx. Y aprender de esas personas, dejarlos que sean los líderes y luego ir a votar en educación negra, en educación de K-12. Porque no pueden hacerlo sin aprender, ¿verdad? Y es algo que ella carga mucho con ella, ya que está siguiendo ese trabajo en la ley y en la póliza. So, para seguir en eso, no sé si tienen comentarios. I don't know if anyone has any additional comments. Or we're good to move on. But, oh, wait, I didn't even show anything. Yeah, for solidarity between Latinx and Black communities, I completely agree with everything that y'all said. It's very important, you know, to have those conversations, to do the work of unlearning, but you have to go beyond. And I think there's something we have talked a lot about in our organization that, okay, we had the uncomfortable conversation. We talked about how the anti-Blackness in Latinx communities, now what, you know? We can't just have a conversation and then be like, we did the work. That's not the work. We have to figure out how to apply it, how to go forward, how to make tangible change within our community, within our policy, within our society. And I think that's something that is ongoing work. It's difficult work. But yeah, no, I think the most important step in, like, the beginning step in this is that the Latinx community has a long way to go. We have to confront our own prejudices, especially like generationally with older folks sometimes, you know, but also younger folks, not just older, but just have those intergenerational conversations, have those uncomfortable conversations, challenge those prejudices, challenge that anti-Blackness, and do that work. And then learn how to apply it, you know, actually go out, like Venus said, work with organizations that are doing the work. But yeah, I think the Latinx community just has to take a lead with that. And especially with recognizing, you know, that folks can be Latinx and Black, and they're just as valid, they're just as part of our community. And I think that's something that has lacked a lot, and that's not taught at all. I know I learned more about that in college, which I should not be 20 learning about this. So yeah, but I think it takes a lot, and it starts with us, and we can't expect other people to educate us on that. So lo que yo compartí es que creo que es muy importante entre la comunidad Latinx de enfrentar nuestra propia antinegritud, nuestros propios prejuicios, nuestro propio racismo en la comunidad y empezar ahí, pero también como dijo Vines, lo importante es aplicarlo, no nomás tener la conversación, pero ahora qué vamos a hacer, qué cambios vamos a hacer, cómo los vamos a hacer, qué trabajo tenemos que hacer, ¿verdad? Y así se puede crear más comunicación y más trabajo entre las comunidades, pero también es muy importante que empecemos con nosotros, que no esperemos que la gente negra, la gente afro-latinx nos eduque, ¿verdad? Tenemos que tomar los pasos nosotros para desaprender esas cosas, y especialmente en conversación con reconocer que la gente puede ser negra y latinx, que es algo que nuestra comunidad nos ha hecho mucha, mucha falta y seguimos batallando con eso. La gente no reconoce que puede ser negra y puede ser latinx. A mí es algo que yo comparto, que yo no aprendí más sobre eso hasta el colegio. Yo no aprendí más sobre las comunidades negras en México hasta que tenía como 19, 20 años, que no debería de ser algo que estoy aprendiendo a esa edad como una persona mexicana, ¿verdad? Entonces es muy importante que nosotros tomemos esos pasos antes, en vez de esperar que la gente nos eduque. So moving on to, we also wanted to talk about HBCUs and the importance of them and the significance. So queremos hablar sobre los colegios y universidades históricamente negros y la importancia de ellos y de esos espacios.
Venus is going to help us a little bit with this, but I'll go ahead and, get these out of the way first. But I think it's also important that we have this conversation about HBCUs. And so I think really what I wanted to mention here was one of the first HBCUs, and which is Cheyne University of Pennsylvania. And I think this, the reason why I wanted to put this piece of information is because it's actually critical. Like 1837, I feel like the first college ever made was probably much before that. And the fact that in 1837, the first HBCU was built, I feel like for me, that's kind of ridiculous, because I know there have been universities that have been built much years before then. And so vehicles of freedom and Black liberation, cultivation, and immersion of like Black in Black culture and community. This is what is offered at an HBCU. I can't fully say that this is true because I haven't, been in an HBCU, but I definitely think that Venus can speak on her experience more about this. But I definitely will say, like, there is a lack of recognition and financial support from our government when it comes to HBCUs. I feel like there's a lot of PWIs that get a lot of attention, and especially in the media. And I feel like there is a lack of media coverage and lack of funding and support and recognition from a lot of places when it comes to HBCUs. And I want to go ahead and pass it over to Venus if she wants to speak on her experience.
Let me just translate that real quick. So lo que compartió Andrew es que la primera universidad históricamente negra en los Estados Unidos fue Cheyne University in Pennsylvania. Y lo que él notó es que esa universidad fue establecida en 1837. Y muchos colegios, especialmente colegios blancos, fueron establecidos antes de eso, ¿verdad? Colegios donde nomás podía ir la gente blanca, o ya mayoritariamente gente blanca. Y lo que a él se le hace muy ridículo es que no fue establecido un colegio negro hasta 1837, ¿verdad? Para referencia, I think Berkeley estuvo establecido como en 1886, 1800, por ahí, ¿verdad? So ya existían muchos colegios antes de eso, so pasó mucho tiempo hasta que este fue establecido y, y también para hablar un poco sobre los colegios y la importancia de nuestro ángulo, que no sabemos la realidad de estos colegios, o eso va a compartir Vines, que es como, son como vehículos de liberación blanca, de progreso blanco, liberación negra, de progreso negro, y también la cultivación e inmersión en cultura y comunidad negra, ¿se da? A mí ofrecen una experiencia única e inclusiva a estudiantes negros que escuelas que son mayoritariamente blancas no lo hacen, ¿verdad? Por el hecho que hay mucha gente blanca en estas universidades, por el hecho que la educación es para esa gente blanca, por el hecho de que hay mucha discriminación y racismo en esas escuelas. Y también queremos destacar que es muy importante que Reconocemos que el gobierno no le da bastante reconocimiento y apoyo financiero a estas instituciones. So, mucho dinero va a muchas instituciones que son mayoritariamente blancas, que se consideran más prestigiosas, que son más famosas, y no se da bastante reconocimiento y apoyo a las escuelas que son para los estudiantes negros, pero que también otra gente puede ir, ¿verdad? Pero que son históricamente negros.
Awesome. And before I begin, I just want to say that picture right there of my beautiful school in the yard, the sun beaming through the trees, it's giving me life right now. And I wish so bad I could be right there on the yard looking at my historic, beautiful university. There is real beauty in navigating a space where, as a minority, we are the majority. And on an HBCU campus, that's what it is. The minority is the majority. And there's unity in that. There's empowerment in that. There is hope in that. And I couldn't imagine where I would be if I did not attend HBCU. Luckily for me, at a young age, I wasn't too young, but I knew early on that that's what I wanted. I knew early on that I had to go to HBCU. Also, because I was a military child, because I grew up in Okinawa, Japan, and then I came to Southern California, and my family is originally from the South, but I never was a part of my culture. I never was surrounded. I never was the majority ever in any of these spaces. And so I knew that I wanted to go to HBCU so I could experience that. And there's so much liberation in that, to be immersed in your own culture where you look around and everyone looks just like you. I had never had that before. And not only did everyone look just like me, but everyone was thriving and so accomplished and so motivated and eager to learn and take over the world just as I was, you know? And it's just such a great feeling to be around that. It's so inspiring. And I could go on and on, and you know, I'm trying to save a little bit more for my speech later because I speak to all of this, but especially here on the West Coast, we do not have the recognition we deserve. If it wasn't for me just knowing about HBCUs and knowing that some of my family members who lived in the South had attended HBCUs, my guidance counselors didn't tell me, hey, Venus, you should have, they didn't tell me about HBCUs. My peers, they weren't talking about it. Everybody was just talking about the UCs, you know? So I didn't get to go on college visits through my school to HBCU because obviously there's none on the West Coast. However, I have some amazing, dear, loving parents that out of their own pockets, out of their own money, they took me on an HBCU tour. The summer before my senior year, we went to Howard, we went to Spelman, we went to Hampton, we went to Tuskegee. I went to so many HBCUs. I was on campus. I'm looking at the college life, the Greek life, the sororities, that all of the experience. I got to do that because my parents were just diligent enough to give me that. My educational system didn't provide me with that. I had to do it on my own. So, you know, as we move forward and as we're having these conversations, and as I go back to the accountability aspect, I am making a commitment to hold my local policymakers accountable for just that. Why are you not sponsoring a college trip to HBCUs? However, we get all of these sponsored college trips to all of the UCs. If I can go to the UCs, I can go to the HBCUs. And actually, in my AP literature class, we were required to all fill out that UC application. And it actually really bothered me because I knew I don't want to go to HBCU. I don't want to go to HBCU. So why do I have to sit here and write all these essays to apply? but it was a requirement. So in that same token, why can't I be required by my school system to apply to a HBCU? You know, so it's just realizing the deficiency and providing a different reality. And definitely there is a huge lack of government support. Howard is federally funded. So to speak to that, I would say organizations, this is my call to action to organizations, you know, set aside some money that you get from these nonprofit organizations, set aside some money for a scholarship fund, you know, and make sure that you're targeting HBCU students or those who are prospective HBCU students. So it's about scholarships. We can't, you know, it's going to take a while to fix the government aspect, but what can we do at this level? And that's something we can do.
Absolutely love that last point, and you're so right about that. Like, change is going to take a while, so it's like, what can we do for now, you know? Sí, lo que compartió Venus, como para recordarlos, va a Howard University, que es una HBCU muy prominente. Y ella lo que habla, que lo más importante ha sido de ir de ser una minoría a ser la mayoría, ¿verdad? En una escuela donde toda la gente se ve como ella, toda la gente es de la misma comunidad y comparte esa cultura, y que le ha dado un sentimiento de mucho orgullo, de mucha esperanza, de mucha unidad entre ella y su escuela y la gente que va ahí, que comparte su comunidad y su cultura, que le da mucho esfuerzo, ¿verdad? Ver eso y ver que otras personas como ella estaban haciendo lo que ella quería hacer, estaban haciendo maravillosas cosas con su educación, con sus carreras, estaban logrando las mismas cosas que ella quería lograr, y que estaban haciendo ese trabajo y que eso le daba mucha esperanza. Ella dice que ella decidió ir a un HBCU desde muy joven, quería ir a esas escuelas porque aprendía mucho de los familiares que tenía, que habían ido, pero también lo que ella dice es que no hay bastante reconocimiento, ¿verdad? Especialmente en el oeste creciendo. Dice que si no hubiera sido por su familia, que sabía de estas escuelas, que había ido a estas escuelas, no hubiera sabido ella que esta era una opción, ¿verdad? Porque en la escuela no le enseñaban esto, no se veía mucha fama alrededor de estas escuelas, especialmente en el oeste. Sus counselors en las escuelas no hablaban de esto, sus amigas no querían ir, no sabían que estas escuelas eran sus opciones. Especialmente en California se pucha mucho las UCs, las Cal State. Es lo único que se reconoce, ¿verdad? So, dice ella que tiene mucho orgullo que sabía de familiares que esto era una opción, porque de otro modo no hubiera sabido, ¿verdad? Ella tenía que buscarlas en su propio modo, se tenía que educar de este sistema de HBCUs ella misma, porque el sistema no le estaba dando esa educación. Y dijo que no había opciones para visitar esas escuelas, como hay muchas opciones para las UCs. Muchas veces las prepas te llevan a visitar estas escuelas en grupos, en clubs en la escuela, los mismos maestros te llevan, pero para las escuelas que ella quería ir, no había esa opción. So que sus propios padres tomaron el trabajo de pagarle los tickets y los boletos y todo para poder ir a visitar escuelas. So visitó Howard, Spelman, Tuskegee y Hampton en el este. Y pudo ver cómo eran las escuelas, cómo era la comunidad en esas escuelas, cómo era la vida del colegio en HBCUs, y que agradece mucho que tuvo esa opción porque el sistema de la escuela en California no le estaba dando esa educación, esos recursos. So ella también habló sobre su experiencia donde en las escuelas tenía que aplicar a UCs, eso era un requerimiento que apliquen a universidades en California, aunque ella sabía que no quería ir a una de esas, que quería ir a un HBCU. Y ella habla sobre por qué no era un requerimiento llenar una aplicación a un HBCU, si ese era su futuro de ella, si esa era su esperanza, ¿verdad? Y también habla de la falta del apoyo del gobierno. So le llama a muchas organizaciones que están haciendo trabajo de non-profit que separen dinero para apoyar a estudiantes que están yendo a HBCUs, para apoyar en becas, en trabajos, porque va a tomar mucho tiempo en hacer cambio en nuestro sistema de educación. So, ¿qué podemos hacer ahorita nosotros como líderes en organizaciones en la comunidad, ¿verdad? Y no esperar que cambie el sistema para nosotros, pero apoyarnos con lo que tenemos ahorita. Yeah, and I just want to say thank you so much, Venus, for sharing that. There's also space to share anything else you want to share about HBCUs, about your experience, but I really, really appreciate your words. So, nomás le quiero decir a Venus que agradecemos mucho, mucho sus palabras y su experiencia y que esté compartiendo eso con nosotros sobre las HBCUs y que siempre está aquí el espacio para si quiere compartir más. So, I don't know if y'all are cool with moving on.
Yeah, we can move forward.
Okay, for sure. So en esta parte queríamos hablar de figuras prominentes en la comunidad negra y en la historia negra. So we just wanted to highlight some prominent figures in Black history and in the Black community. And something that I just want to share really quick about this before we go on is that we see many common themes throughout the narratives that have been pushed in history about these Black figures or how they're recognized by our society. A lot of times we see erasure of their politics and also their identities. So a lot of folks will have their queer identities erased, you know, or they'll have their radical politics erased. A lot of Black figures will be socialist, communist, radical revolutionary leaders, and that'll be really erased to make people more palatable to our community, especially to white communities. And I think it's just very important that we truthfully and genuinely honor people and their histories and make sure that they're taught correctly and not watered down to what is acceptable by our society. And also recognize sometimes the themes of state violence that are very, very prominent against a lot of revolutionary figures that to this day now they're like honored by our state and our government, but when they were around, they were targeted. So I think that's just very important to honor in every figure that we go over. And also everything that we share, we wanna like encourage everyone to take the responsibility to teach themselves, to seek out information on their own and take things that are said by non-Black people with a grain of salt and educate yourself. So una cosa que nomás quería destacar muy rápidamente es los temas que se ven en común en muchas figuras y cómo sus historias son dichas. So muchas veces se borra sus identidades si son queer y sus políticas. So muchas de esas personas eran eran socialistas, eran comunistas, eran revolucionarios, y muchas veces eso se borra para hacer sus historias y su trabajo más bueno para la ciudad, para la comunidad, más fácil de aprender, ¿verdad? So es muy importante para aprender la historia verdaderamente y honrar a la gente verdaderamente, ¿verdad? Y también se ve mucho el tema de violencia del Estado contra esas figuras, que en este momento ya llegamos a un momento donde el Estado y el gobierno celebra y honra a esas personas según, pero en el tiempo cuando esas gentes vivían, se veían como una amenaza. Y se hacía mucha violencia contra ellos de parte del gobierno y del Estado. Eso nomás es algo de acordarse. Y también les queremos decir que aprendan a ustedes mismos, busquen la información y tomen todo que dice la gente que no es negra, no por hecho, ¿verdad? Aprendan ustedes mismos y busquen la información. So take it away, Andrew.
Yeah, so one prominent figure that I really wanted to highlight, especially because I've learned about him the most, and because I've actually went to his house because he lived in Washington, D.C. So we are going to be talking about Carter G. Woodson, and he was a distinguished Black author, editor, publisher, historian, all of those. I could literally name him. But I will say he is considered the father of Black history because he's the one who actually, he worked with an association, and they were actually the ones to be like, you know what, let's have Black History Month and let's have it the second week of February. But they actually just made it to be the whole month, which is really exciting. And at the same time, it's really important that we have, you know, dedication towards these Black historical figures and recognizing them. And so Carter G. Woodson was someone who believed that it was really important to learn Black history for African-Americans. And he believed that if you were to learn your own history and really divulge yourselves within your own culture, you can become a productive citizen within your society and within your culture in particular. And so the first person actually who received a PhD from Harvard was W.E.B. Du Bois. And the second African-American to obtain a PhD from Harvard was Carter G. Woodson. So just knowing that, I think that's really cool. And I'm so glad that, you know, they were the stepping stones for more Black individuals to obtain a PhD, not just from an Ivy League school, from other institutions such as HBCUs, UCs, Harvard itself. And so I think that's really important to really emphasize, because they really, like Carter G. Woodson and other these prominent Black figures, they really did give back to their community. And I feel like not a lot of people realize the impact they made. And so I think this is something that we really wanted to emphasize today.
Sí, so la primera figura que vamos a estar destacando es Carter G. Woodson, que fue un autor negro y editor y histórico. Y como dice Andrew, logró mucho en su vida, so hay mucho de compartir sobre él y su trabajo. Y esa es una de las cosas más importantes. También se conoce como el padre de la historia negra. So él era parte de una asociación que querían establecer un tiempo para honrar y celebrar la historia negra, y de primero se planeaba que iba a ser una semana en febrero, y luego terminó siendo todo el mes en febrero, ¿verdad? Que como dice Andrew, es maravilloso que se escogió todo el mes, pero todavía más trabajo que hacer con eso, y celebrar a la gente todo el año y honrarlos todo el año, ¿verdad? Pero que es muy importante que tomemos este tiempo, que haya este espacio para honrar y celebrar estas figuras. Él también creía que era muy importante que la gente afroamericana o negra aprenda la historia negra para poder ser ciudadanos en la ciudad, en la sociedad. So, él pensaba que era muy importante que si uno sabía su propia historia, podía hacer el trabajo que necesitaba su comunidad, ¿verdad? Y como compartió Andrew, él fue el segundo afroamericano que agarró un doctorado de Harvard, y el primero fue W.E. Du Bois, que también es una figura muy prominente que hizo trabajo muy importante en la comunidad. Y lo que dice Andrew, que la importancia también es que estas figuras y esas personas como Carter G. Woodson, de veras que quebraron muchos obstáculos, ¿verdad? Y sobrepasaron muchos obstáculos que les dio el paso para las generaciones que vinieron después de ellos para completar esos mismos logros, para poder ir a escuelas y agarrar doctorados, para poder agarrar la educación que querían y hacer las cosas que querían en su comunidad. Y así les siguió muchos individuales negros que no nomás agarraron sus PhDs de Harvard, de escuelas blancas, pero también de HBCUs. So es muy importante ver el impacto que tuvieron y cómo el trabajo que hicieron sigue afectando a la comunidad y los logros de la comunidad.
And then, wait, just to kind of talk about this, Fabiola, the way we're going to do it is just me read and then translate after, correct?
Yes.
Okay, cool. So another prominent figure that we did want to mention, and it's not just a male figure. We have a female figure, so Angela Davis, and I think that's really important because she was part of the Black Panther community, activist, prison abolitionist. She's also a writer. And so the FBI most wanted, she's acquitted of murder, kidnapping, and conspiracy charges. So her and her partner, Gina Den, both advocate for the Black liberation, Palestinian solidarity, and prison policing abolition. And so I think this is also another important figure because she really did give back to the community, especially considering that she was an activist and prison abolitionist. My apologies. I think that's really important when considering giving back to the Black community. And then you can go ahead and jump in, Fabiola.
Yeah, so just something really important to highlight first is Angela Davis and Fred Hampton were both part of the Black Panther Party. And I think this is particularly important to highlight because a lot of folks that are involved in Somos Familia are from the Bay Area, and the Black Panther Party was very centered in Oakland. So it's very important to recognize that history and what they did directly for that community that continues to impact the Black community in Oakland. I have the translated version of what I wrote down, my bad. The Black Panther Party, just really quick to share, it's obviously very complex, very much to say, but just for like a brief thing, they did a lot of community work in fighting for housing, justice, and land, most importantly, for the Black community, and wanted to end police brutality as well. They were part of a larger Black Power movement at that time that prioritized community supervision over the police, Black pride, and civil rights for the Black community, and end of brutality and injustice. So Angela Davis es una activista y una abolicionista de la prisión, y una educadora, una escritora, ha enseñado en muchas UCs y sigue haciendo el trabajo, ¿verdad? A un punto, esta Angela Davis estaba involucrada en el Black Panther Party como una comunista también, basada en esas ideologías, y a un punto la estaba buscando el FBI, pero la cargaron con asesino, con kidnapping y con conspiración, pero no fue a la cárcel. Y también es muy importante reconocer el ataque del Estado en esta parte, ¿verdad? Y cómo ella desafió un ataque por todo el gobierno y sigue educando hasta este momento sobre sus ideas y sus ideologías y sobre su experiencia. Ella y su pareja Gina Dent siguen siendo abogadas para liberación negra, para la solidaridad del palestinian y también para la abolición de las prisiones y de la policía. So esos son muchos temas que son muy importantes hasta este momento, ¿verdad? I don't know if you want to go on to highlight Fred Hampton, Andrew.
Yeah, so Fred Hampton, he was a Black leader in Chicago who was a communist, and he was anti-capitalist, so props to him. And he was also an organizer, and he was just really a charismatic public speaker. But something that we did mention earlier was we wanted to recognize that these prominent historic figures, a lot of the times during their time, they were considered as a threat. And now, as we look and reflect on the past, we really highlight them and honor them and recognize them. And I think that's not the best way to do it. And it's crazy to say, because he was identified by the FBI as like this radical threat, because he had this large gathering of people, he had this whole community, and his powerful like leadership really presented like through his community. And I just feel like his story is something that we should really reflect on, because I guess what I'm trying to say is we shouldn't just recognize him for all the good things that we've done, but we also wanted to recognize that he was seen in this perspective in a bad way from other people, and that's not something I don't know how to correctly say this, but like it's important to see him as this prominent Black figure, and not like, we also just want to acknowledge like the perspective of what others had of him. That's what I'm trying to say. Mm-hmm. And so I think this is really important to highlight. So I kind of just wanted to like spiel that in, but Fabiola, take the lead.
Yeah, thank you so much for sharing that, Andrew. Yeah, I think one of the most important things, especially when it comes to Fred Hampton and a lot of other Black Panther leaders or just radical revolutionaries or like radical leaders of their time or of this time, is that they're often erased. Their stories aren't told because they were like such radical revolutionaries who were seen as a threat to our current system and our current state. And I think Fred Hampton's story in particular is very tragic because he was 21. He was so, so young. Most of us are 21 and we were so, so young, and he was seen as a threat by the state to the point that he was murdered by them in his sleep, you know? So I think his story is particularly very, very tragic and really represents like the violence that is perpetuated against these figures, even as a kid who was, he was just 21, you know? And they were seen as powerful, as radical threats because of their power, because of their ability to bring the community together, because of their leadership skills. And that was just seen as a threat to the current system that we have. So Fred Hampton era un líder de los Black Panthers in Chicago. Era un comunista, era un anticapitalista, un activista, un organizador, y también un orador público que era muy carismático y muy efectivo. Por esas razones, Fred Hampton, el Estado lo veía como una amenaza, porque era tan un líder tan maravilloso, porque tenía tanto talento en traer la comunidad juntas y en traer la comunidad empoderada. Y él fue asesinado por la policía a la edad de 21, cuando estaba dormido. So nomás es muy importante reconocer cómo la violencia del Estado contra la gente negra era presente en estos tiempos y sigue presente. Como dije, Fred Hampton más tenía 21 años y se veía como una amenaza, no porque una persona mala, no porque estaba haciendo cosas malas, pero porque era tan poderoso en traer la comunidad y el poder de la comunidad junte. Y él era una amenaza para el sistema y el sistema que el Estado quiere dejar en lugar, ¿verdad? So por eso fue asesinado cuando más tenía 21 años. We have some quick comments. Someone says, hello from Mexico, Héctor Salazar. Héctor is a psychologist in Mexico. Y Maritza dice, es muy importante que todos aprendamos la historia negra. Como dijo Vines, la historia negra es la historia americana y mundial. Maritza said, it's very important we learn that Black history. Like Vines said, Black history is American history and world history. And Nancy said, gracias por educarnos. Thank you for educating us. So if anyone has any additional comments, that's great. If not, we'll move on to the next figures we wanted to highlight really quick.
Yeah, so we're going to go ahead and talk about Martin Luther King and Malcolm X. And I think a lot of people know these prominent figures because they're mostly talked about. But I think it's really important that we also include these individuals. Martin Luther King was a prominent leader of the civil rights movement, and he led the Montgomery bus boycott with Claudette Colvin, Rosa Parks, and they marched on Washington in 1963. And essentially all of this really helped bring about legislation such as the Civil Rights Act and the Voting Rights Act. And so history often like co-opts him and represents him in a way that is more palatable for white people. And this is something that Fabiola had mentioned earlier before speaking about these Black figures, is that a lot of the times these historical figures are represented in a way that is just more comfortable for white people to understand. And there's a lot of things that we really history doesn't really like to teach us, especially within the educational system, because it's not comfortable. And I feel like we really need to have these uncomfortable conversations in order to really push forward. So I think Martin Luther King was definitely an individual who really exemplified that. And I think it's important that we really highlight him here today, and especially during this month.
Gracias, Andrew. So en esta parte estamos hablando más bien de líderes en el movimiento para derechos civiles. Una figura que me aseguro que muchos lo conocen, es Martin Luther King Jr. Él fue un líder muy prominente en el movimiento de derechos civiles y fue el líder del boycott de autobuses en Montgomery, que también fue iniciado por las acciones de Claudette Colvin y Rosa Parks. Me aseguro que muchos conocen a Rosa Parks cuando ella inició este movimiento, cuando no quiso dar su espacio a una persona blanca en el autobús, pero muchas veces no hablamos de Claudette Colvin, una muchacha más joven que hizo eso antes de Rosa Parks, pero no fue la cara del movimiento porque no se veía como una persona ideal para ser la cara del movimiento. Es muy importante que también destaquemos las personas que en su momento también fueron borradas de la historia. Y ese movimiento también causó, hizo posible el acto de derechos civiles y el acto de votar, que le dio más derechos a la comunidad negra, especialmente en el trabajo cívico de poder votar. Y algo muy importante que también queríamos destacar de MLK Jr. es que muchas veces la historia lo coapta y lo representa en un modo que es más cómodo para la gente blanca. Muchas veces no se hablan de su política, que era más radical, de lo que él de veras quería, del cambio que quería y lo que representaba para un país que priorizaba las vidas blancas arriba de las vidas negras. So es muy importante que aprendamos su política y su historia realmente, y que también reconocemos el papel que tuvo el Estado contra Martin Luther King. Porque a este momento que llegamos, yo veo que a veces, muchas veces, agencias del Estado, agencias del gobierno lo reconocen y lo honran. Y también tenemos que hablar del papel que tenían esas mismas agencias, ese mismo gobierno en su muerte.
Thank you, Fabiola. And moving forward with our next prominent figure, we really also had wanted to include Malcolm X. And so just kind of going down these like bullet points, he was a human and civil rights activist, also a minister, and he was, a lot of people within our society believe that he was like mistaught, villainized. And the reason why, just as like many other powerful Black figures, a lot of people looked at him this way because he, for me, when I think of Malcolm X, people see him as like the anti-Martin Luther King, because Martin Luther King was pushing towards peace and prosperity and like making change with like injustice, I guess like through peace. But Malcolm X said, like in his statement right here, there's no such thing as a nonviolent revolution. And so I really think what Malcolm X was pushing for was creating change within this community. But the thing is, sometimes it's not just roses and butterflies. And I think that's what Malcolm X really you know, push towards. And I mean, and like, just to talk about what people thought about him, like within society, I don't know. I think there's more to Malcolm X and what people see on the surface level. And I think not a lot of people realize that. So I think it's important that we are talking about him now in ways that he actually did do, like, really good things. And so I think that's something that we really wanted to highlight and emphasize here in today's discussion.
Thank you, Andrew. And I completely agree. I think often what we see in our educational system with MLK Jr. is that his politics are often erased. You know, he's made to be able to be like more digestible for white people learning about Black history. And what we see with Malcolm X often, I know, like the little education that I received about him in school, is that he was like the anti-MLK, that he was the violent one, which is like seen as a bad thing, that he was the radical one, which is also seen as a bad thing. So his like radical politics are seen as a negative, as a threat, and that's why he's not taught. And when he is, it's in a negative light. So I think that's important that like we learn and we recognize like the biases that perpetuate the history that we're taught. So Malcolm X era un activista para derechos civiles y humanos y también un pastor con la Nación de Islam por un rato. Y algo importante de desaprender de Malcolm X por lo que nos ha enseñado el sistema de educación y la sociedad es que muchas veces él se ve como una persona mala, como una persona que era violenta y que no quería el mismo cambio que Martin Luther King Jr. Y esto pasa muchas veces con figuras negras poderosas, como vimos con Angela Davis y con Fred Hampton, que se ven como personas, porque son radicales, se ven como personas malas y como personas que son una amenaza al Estado. Y unos pensamientos de él que queríamos compartir. Él dijo que que la gente negra se deshaga de las cadenas del racismo por cualquier medio necesario. Y algo que compartió él, que se conoce mucho sobre su política, es que él dijo que no hay una cosa como una revolución pacífica. Y como dijo Andrew, a lo mejor la gente toma esto como algo negativo, como algo que es una amenaza, como algo que es muy violento. El cambio y la revolución no siempre es como cosas positivas, no siempre son cosas fáciles, no siempre son, como dijo Andrew, mariposas y flores, ¿verdad? Y eso es algo que tenemos que reconocer cuando aprendemos de Malcolm X. Y luego, yendo a nuestra última figura, Audre Lorde.
So we wanted to talk about our last figure here, and we wanted to make sure that it was another female figure, because I think it's also important that we have this balance between female and male figures. So we wanted to touch upon Audre Lorde, who's also a writer, feminist, womanist, and civil rights activist. And I think Audre Lorde, she was really known for her poems, and her poems and prose largely deal with like issues related to like civil rights, feminism, homophobia, lesbianism, illness, disability, and really just about like the exploration of like female and like Black identity. And so she really dedicated both of her life and creative talent to like confronting and addressing these injustices in these different areas. And I feel like her poems have really expressed what it's really like to live during these times as a Black feminist, womanist, writer, and civil rights activist. And she really gave back to her community, not through these works like MLK and like Malcolm X, but really through poems, because I think through expression and through her words, she was able to still have a large impact on her community.
Thank you, Andrew. Oh my gosh, I love Audre Lorde. Okay, so la última figura que queríamos destacar es Audre Lorde, era una escritora, una feminista y una activista para los derechos civiles. Ella se describía ella misma como una mujer negra, una lesbiana, una madre, una guerrera y una poeta. Y eso de veras enseña en su trabajo. Ella dedicó su vida y su trabajo y su talento creativo a enfrentar y hablar sobre las injusticias del racismo, del sexismo, del clasismo, del capitalismo, de heterosexismo y homofobia. Y mucho de esto se ve en su trabajo, ¿verdad? En muchos de sus poemas hablan sobre su frustración, sobre su enojo hacia las injusticias sociales y civiles, especialmente en su posición en la sociedad, ¿verdad? Como una mujer lesbiana, como una mujer negra, como una madre, como una creativa negra. Y nomás creo que es muy importante que reconozcamos cómo gente también, en ciertos modos, unos trabajan más en organizar, en organizaciones, en la comunidad, y también cómo la gente puede usar su talento, ¿verdad?, para hacer cambio y para hacer ese trabajo, como hizo Audre Lorde. Y eso acaba nuestro segmento de las figuras prominentes. Y ahora queríamos tomar como unos 5 minutos para enseñarles esta película corta que se llama Hair Love. So that is the end of our highlighting of historical figures. And now we wanted to take a few moments to show y'all a short film called Hair Love, which is an Oscar-winning film created and directed by Matthew A. Cherry. And the importance of this film is its representation of Black hair, especially in young Black girls. And also the creator talked about working to counter and disprove negative stereotypes of Black fathers. So it's a lovely film, and we just wanted to share it with y'all real quick so y'all can, I don't know, it's really nice, it's really cute, and just so y'all can watch it and kind of think about the issues that it brings up. A ver. Nos estamos arreglando para poder compartirla. Ojalá que trabaje. Aquí tenemos otro comentario de Héctor. Oh my gosh. No sé si se va a poder oír, Andrew. Si no se puede oír, le vamos a proveer con el enlace para que lo puedan ver en su propio tiempo. Pero ojalá que sí. Is there any audio?
There's no more audio when you mute yourself. Did the video stop?
See, I can't make it full screen, it stops.
Oh, it's fine. You could just leave it how it was.
Okay. That's my internet. Thank you for your patience with the technology.
That was so cute.
I loved it. That was my first time actually fully watching the video. I loved it. So sweet and so real. That was me and my dad years ago. You know, thankfully now I can do my own hair and I can do my own stuff, but that is a very real reality. And so I'm glad that at the end, it magnified just having love for our different hair and just having love for our differences as a whole.
Exactly. And I think another thing that I wanted to like really emphasize and like point out too is I feel like, you know, there's this emphasis on like wearing your hair natural and some people are afraid to do so. And I think it was really beautiful when the mom was like, you know what, I'm still beautiful even with, like, I'm still a princess even when it's off. And so I thought that was really touching and beautiful.
Thank you. Yeah, what lo que compartió Andrew y Venus compartió que era su primera vez viendo todo el video y también de Andrew, y que de veras reflejó una realidad para niñas jóvenes negras, especialmente cuando sus padres hacen su pelo, y que dice que ella y su padre también tuvieron una relación similar donde la ayudaba, pero ahora ella lo hace ella misma, ya aprendió, ¿verdad? y que sí refleja algo que es una experiencia muy común. Y también lo que compartió Andrew, que le encantó cómo enseñaron que te pongas el pelo natural, y que enseñó que la madre todavía es una reina, ¿verdad? Como ella dice, tenga el pelo que tenga, aunque no tenga. Y a Vienes también le gustó que enseñó mucho amor a diferentes pelos, a diferentes texturas, y el amor que puede tener eso, que puede crear eso en comunidad, ¿verdad? So, ojalá que todos aprendieron algo de ese video, les gustó, les vamos a dar acceso al video en los comentarios y en nuestra página de Facebook para que lo puedan ver, se lo puedan enseñar a sus familias. So yeah, I hope you all like learned something from the video. I hope you liked it. We'll be sharing it in the comments and in our Facebook page. So y'all can like share it with your community, share it with your family and friends, and just learn something from that video. And now we wanted to share some resources. Queríamos compartir unos recursos. So tenemos, esto vamos a compartir la presentación con ustedes si quieren saber más sobre estos recursos. Una de ellas es cómo donar a HBCUs. So la fundación de HBCU se dona a esa organización que ayuda directamente a estudiantes que están en la high school y quieren ir a un HBCU, o estudiantes que ya están en HBCU y los prueben con becas, con internships, con trabajos, con diferentes oportunidades, y de veras crea una comunidad donde todos aprenden sobre HBCUs, donde estudiantes que ya están en una HBCU pueden ser apoyados. También estamos compartiendo el Black Life Network, que es una página que tiene mucha información en un solo lugar, que ayuda mucho y es muy importante. Eso tiene diferente información sobre negocios negros, creadores negros, cuando viene a diferentes cosas como noticias, maquillaje, pelo, libros, muchas diferentes cosas. Y también tiene acceso a libros gratis por personas como las figuras sobre las que hablamos, como Malcolm X, Angela Davis, Frederick Douglass, diferente información para que puedan aprender más. Y también tenemos un enlace a organizaciones en la área de la Bahía peleando por justicia social y civil y racial. Organizaciones fundando apoyo a gente que está viviendo en la calle, en lugares como Oakland o otras áreas de la Bahía, apoyando a gente en la cárcel, apoyando gente con luchas legales. Y también nomás un punto les queríamos decir que como muchos de ustedes están en Facebook o en otras medios sociales, que cuando ven que gente está colectando dinero por modos personales, que también prioricen donando a gente directamente. Ya sé que a veces muchas madres están en GoFundMe, mucha gente trans y negra está preguntando por dinero en Venmo o en GoFundMe, y que se acuerden que como es importante apoyar a organizaciones, también es muy importante apoyar a miembros de la comunidad directamente cuando lo necesitan, porque muchas veces es una emergencia y siento como que mucha gente no se siente cómodo con dar dinero a la gente directamente, pero es uno de los modos más directos de apoyarlos. Do you want me to go over that, Andrew? Or would you like to?
If you want, you can go over it, my pleasure.
Yeah, so we're just sharing a few resources. So how to donate to students aspiring or already going to HBCUs. So the HBCU Foundation provides different opportunities for both students in high school who are interested in going to HBCUs or students already at HBCUs to support them in different ways, providing scholarships, internships, and different resources to support the students in their journey through high school and through HBCU, and to just create community and community support. We're also linking organizations in the Bay Area fighting for social and racial and civil justice. So different legal funds supporting people to pay bail, to fight their legal battles. And also a lot of organizations, especially in East Oakland, who provide relief and other resources to unhoused folks in that area, which we know is a lot of times Black and Brown folks in those communities. We also link the Black Life Network, which provides a lot of different resources that are all collected in one single space, which is very helpful. So it has access to different Black creators, different Black business owners, and it kind of shows you how you can support these different businesses and how you can find them. It goes from like hotels to Black creators in makeup to hair, different businesses, restaurants, media, and it also has access to free PDFs by people like the figures that we covered, like Malcolm X, Angela Davis, Frederick Douglass. So y'all can take a look if you need that. And it also gives you access to different places to donate to. So just a collection of a lot of different resources. And we also want to encourage y'all, especially y'all that are on Facebook or different social medias, to be comfortable and prioritize donating to people directly. A lot of times people have GoFundMes right now. A lot of families, single mothers are struggling with that. We see a lot of times Black trans folks asking for donations through GoFundMe, through Venmo. And I know a lot of people are more comfortable maybe donating to organizations, and it seems a little different to donate to people directly, but it's one of the best ways to get emergency funds and direct personal support that you know is gonna go to the person. So just, yeah, be more comfortable with like donating directly to folks when they're asking for help, even if it's just a little bit.
Yeah, and it goes a long way too. I think that's a lot of things that people forget, is that like when you're donating, that doesn't mean you need to donate your whole bank account. I think just donating like any little bit that you can is just meaningful within itself. And I'm pretty sure the person on the other side receiving that would really benefit and thank your support. So that's something that I want to mention as well, too.
Yeah, and even sharing, like, compartiendo esos GoFundMes, esos Venmos, cuando mm-hmm. no tienes nada. So, like, even, like, a retweet, a like, getting mm-hmm. the word out there.
Yeah, getting the word out. Yeah.
Yeah, and just for our closing, we're going to give some space to Venus to share some things. And also just want to say thank you to all of you. I know it's been like a long program, but there was a lot to say and we didn't want to cut anything short. So just want to thank you for your patience, for sharing this space with us, especially you, Venus. Thank you so, so much for being here and for sharing everything that you did. It was so lovely to meet you because Andrew loves you. And it was just so great to have you here. I'm so glad you took some time out of your Saturday. I'm sorry it ran so long, but we really appreciate it so, so much. So nomás queríamos agradecerle también a Venus. Muchas gracias por estar aquí, por tomar el tiempo, porque ya sé que Andrew tiene mucho amor para ti y gracias por tomar tanto tiempo en tu sábado para compartir con nosotros y hacer este trabajo. So just leaving this space open.
Awesome. So first of all, I'm so honored to be a part of this space. And even for, you know, we did go over a little bit of time, but that's okay because that's Black history. You know, we need more time for Black history. So the fact that we didn't cut the program, we didn't leave anything out, that speaks to the importance of our topic. And the conversation lives on, not just after this presentation, but also after February, after Black History Month. And so I'm confident that the viewers watching, those who will view this program, those who are already a part of Somos Familia, that they will continue the conversation beyond Black History Month. And I don't want to take up too much time because I know, Fabiola, you've been doing an amazing job at translating. So I'm going to try to keep it short, but I'm a long-winded person. But I do want to just end on one note. I was on a panel a couple weeks ago with Miss Latasha Brown, who is the co-founder of Black Voters Matter. And she did this great icebreaker where she had everyone close their eyes and breathe and ground themselves. And she asked the question, imagine what would America look like if racism didn't exist? And it was a great challenge. It was a great icebreaker. And we had a great response. However, I consider myself, you know, a realist with a lot of optimism. So I want to tweak that question and I want you all to close your eyes and imagine what would America look like with honest equity, diversity, and inclusion. And so for the ones that are watching on Facebook, you can put that in the chat and you can say that looks like hope, that looks like optimism, whatever it is. And also Fabiola and Andrew, you can let me know what that looks like to you. And before, as you're thinking about it, just realize that diversity is being invited to the party while inclusion is being asked to dance. And I'll repeat that. Diversity is being invited to the party and inclusion is being asked to dance. So with that honest equity, that diversity, and that inclusion, we're being asked to participate. We're being asked to dance. We're being asked to not just have a seat at the table, but also bring our voice to the table. And so what I hope that everybody takes away from this wonderful program, if not anything else, but to think about that question daily as you go into any space you're in, if you're a teacher, if you're an educator, if you're a student, if you're a voter, if you're a parent, Think about that question. What would America look like with honest equity, diversity, and inclusion? And when you think about that every day, you make the vision a little bit clearer and you make a personal commitment to yourself and to the action behind that question. So to me, that looks like educating more of my peers here on the West Coast who are in high school or in middle school, educating them on the HBCU process, educating them on how to get to a HBCU. That's what that looks like to me. So every day I am making a commitment to myself on how can I get at least one more person to know about a HBCU. So it can look like anything to you and it can look like anything to anyone. I just want you all to be left with that question and really think about your commitment to your answer. So yeah, thank you so much for having me. I'm so thrilled and pleased. Andrew, I love you so much. I'm so proud of you. Fabiola, you are amazing. I'm so happy that I made a connection with the Somos Familia. So I am always a person of connections. If I ever have any opportunity or chance to highlight you all and your actions, I will definitely do so. So thank you, Somos Familia. Thank you, Fabiola. Thank you, Andrew.
Thank you so much, Venus. I'm like about to cry.
thank you.
Thank you. That was really well said, and I don't think you could have said it any better. And I think that's a really great question that people should think about as we close today. So thank you.
No, yeah. Thank you so much. Lovely, lovely words. I love it so much. And like Andrew said, you could not have said it better. And I love how you emphasize, you know, that commitment to that change. Like, what does it look like now? How can we make it happen? You know, I love that. And I just want to share, I shared some short thoughts. I'll translate it right now, but something that someone shared in the comments is, I asked, what does a world without racism look like to you? And Nancy shared, it looks like a legacy I'm willing to work for to lead to our next generation. Thank you so much, Nancy. Just to translate that for everyone watching. Oh gosh. So Venus compartió que participó en un evento organizada por Miss Latasha Brown, que trabaja con la organización de Black Votes Matter, y que un rompehielo que hizo es que le preguntó a todos los participantes que cierren sus ojos y imaginen cómo se ve un América donde el racismo no existe. Y Venus nomás quiere compartir eso con ustedes y decirles que también practiquen esa práctica, ¿verdad? Que cierren sus ojos, imagínense cómo se ve un mundo sin racismo, imagínense un futuro donde no hay racismo, ¿verdad? Que es el primer paso al cambio. Y dice esta Venus que ella se considera una realista, pero que también tiene mucho optimismo. So quiere que todos se imaginen una América donde hay equidad, donde hay diversidad y donde hay inclusión, donde esos son los valores en el que está basado la sociedad. Pero también compartió esta Vines la importancia de también hacer ese compromiso, de imaginarse cómo se ve el futuro, pero también cómo podemos hacer esos cambios. A mí quiere que todos se dediquen a eso, ¿verdad? ¿Cómo se ve el futuro? Pero también, ¿qué voy a hacer yo para crear ese futuro? Para crear esa sociedad sin racismo, para crear ese mundo diferente, ¿verdad? I think I'm missing some things. I am so sorry. Pero también, nomás que decir esta, Vines, muchas gracias por el espacio para compartir su experiencia, su vida, su trabajo. Y que también agradece mucho que Somos Familia la haya invitado. Algo muy sabio que compartió Vines es que la diferencia entre la diversidad, la inclusión y la equidad, ¿verdad? Que reconozcamos a qué punto tiene que llegar el mundo para llegar a ese momento de veras tener justicia. Y algo que compartió es que la diversidad es ser invitada a la fiesta, pero la inclusión es ser invitada a bailar. No es bastante invitar a las personas, no es bastante tener más representación. Es importante también amplificar las voces, amplificar el liderazgo de la comunidad negra. Como dijo, no nomás es sobre invitar, es sobre también darle espacio a su voz y a su experiencia. A mí creo que es algo muy importante eso, que no nomás es sobre diversidad, es sobre inclusión verdadera. A mí agradezco mucho que Vines haya compartido eso con nosotros. Y sí, nomás su única cosa que nos deja con es que el compromiso a ese cambio, ¿verdad? Imaginen cómo se va a ver y que hagan un compromiso y se dediquen a hacer ese cambio. Yeah, so I love those last thoughts you left us with, Venus. Thank you so much again. I can't say it enough. Thank you so much for being here, for taking the time, for just being in this space with us and sharing everything that you did share.
We really appreciate it, just not from Fabiola and I, but from the entire Somos Familia, so.
Yeah, before like letting anyone go, I do want to share that. A lot of people are saying thank you so much. Hector dice, muy interesante, valoro mucho lo que han expresado. So very interesting, I value a lot what y'all have expressed. Gracias infinitamente por estar concientizar a la gente por este, gracias infinitamente. So he says, a million thank yous for bringing this consciousness to everyone and bringing like this thought to everyone's heads. Translate that wrong. But yeah, no, everyone's really, really thankful. I know it's something that this organization really needs to focus on and do more work on. So I really appreciate you supporting us in this. So if anyone has any last thoughts, or we can close up.
I think we're pretty set.
Yeah, so just one last thank you to both of you, to everyone that was watching. So gracias a los dos, Andrew y Venus, por tomar el tiempo. Y también muchas gracias a todos los que nos acompañaron en aprender y desaprender tantas cosas. Y como dijo Venus, esa conversación sigue. Después del mes de febrero, después de esta conversación que tuvimos, el trabajo y la conversación sigue. So muchas gracias a todos. Que tengan buen fin de semana. Bye, adiós.
Bye, adiós. Que tengan buen día.